Yes, I'm Batman.
I'm Batman.
I'm Batman, Alfred.
I'm Batman.
I am Batman!
I'm Batman.
I'm Batman.
Greetings, Bat Family. Welcome back to Holy BatCast, brought to you by Real Fans for Real Movies. Please visit our website, holybatcast.com. It is your one-stop shop for all things Holy BatCast. But you can also find us all over the damn internet on Instagram, on Facebook, on Twitter, on YouTube. Just search for Holy BatCast and you will find us. You can also support the show. If you love the show, you can do that on Patreon. You can go to patreon.com/holybatcast. And as always, the biggest of thank yous to our patrons. We know you guys don't have to do it, but you do it anyway. So bless you. We love you. Thank you for being part of the family. We're part of the Real Fans Podcast Network. So if you are looking for other shows to sample, you can do that at rf4rm.com. And as always, I'm your host, Andy DeGenova. Hello. If you'd like to follow me, you can do that on Twitter or on Instagram. It's just my name, Andy DeGenova. Now, this episode, we are going to be talking about the latest rumblings we have about the Matt Reeves's The Batman. That's what I was trying to say. Because guess what? Stuff is happening. Is it real? Is it rumor? I don't know, but we're going to talk about it because it's a Batman show, damn it. And so joining me, I have not one, but two fine fiends from the Batman Rogues Gallery. First of all, our very own Catwoman down under. It's Brendan Lowe. Hey, Brendan.
Good afternoon, everyone, or good night where you are. How are we?
Great. How are you? Good to have you back.
Pretty good. Yeah, it's. I mean, we were looking at maybe trying to squeeze something in this weekend anyway, and then it wasn't going to happen. And now it's just like, there might be some news.
Yes, all this stuff happened. And true story, I came from the airport and immediately jumped on this so I could talk to you guys. That's how dedicated I am. And plus, this is stuff we need to talk about. Also joining us, it is not Jamie Drooley. Jamie had a very busy weekend, so he is unavailable. He's taking care of kids, being a parent, being a responsible adult. Ew, why would you do that? So we have an old friend of the show joining us. You know him well. It's Mr. Sean Gerber. Hey, Sean.
Hey, Andy. Thanks for having me on the show. I'd wish you'd not stuck me with a slow news week for my reappearance on Holy BatCast, but we'll go on anyway.
We'll figure out, it doesn't take much for us to fill an hour, Sean.
No, it takes literally nothing.
Literally nothing. And if Brendan's our Catwoman, that means you're our Penguin. Sorry.
I'd rather be the freshly read script divisive Joker, if that's okay. I think that's the way I'd like to be known. I am divisive Joker, if that's how I'd like to be known from here on out.
Just want you to know, I read that script and it's got stuff in it. It's got Joker stuff in it.
If I'm not making you mad, I'm not doing my job.
Yeah. Well, anyway, good to have you back, man.
Good to be back. Good to podcast with Brendan, too. I've never had a chance to do that before.
No, we've been following each other for years, but we've never been on the same show.
It's a very special occasion.
It is.
Yeah. Well, it's perfect because
Holy BatCast bringing people together.
You know, it's what we do, or what we try to do. We don't always succeed, but we do what we can. We were talking about like doing something this weekend, and me and Brendan talked about it, and Brendan's and we couldn't get our schedules to align. And then I started talking to Sean about it, and I was like, but I don't even know what to talk about, Sean. And he's like, yeah, I don't know. And so we couldn't figure it out. And then a gift from God. Stuff happened in the last 24 hours and we're like, okay, we're good. We'll start with the biggest news of all, and I think this was last night. Yeah, it was last night when all this happened. We allegedly have our new Batman, and now there's a little bit of conflicting reports as to how far along it is, but it originated in Variety, I think. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And I feel like Variety would not have reported it if it wasn't all but a done deal.
It would be really embarrassing to report this news and then have it not turn out to be true.
Right. Because they reported it as it was a done deal. And then,
well, they didn't say it was a done deal.
They said final negotiations, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. But I was like, it's variety. If it wasn't in Final Negotiations, they would have gone with someone else. I can't remember who it was. Someone else ran a parallel story that was like, oh no, he's one of two front runners.
I believe that was Deadline.
Was it Deadline? Okay. Yep. So Deadline ran that story being like, oh no, it's between Robert I buried the lead. It's between Robert Pattinson and Nicholas Holt. And Variety went, no, Robert Pattinson is your Batman. And those both came out right around the same time. But I feel like if it wasn't a done deal, Variety would have done the same thing, hedged their bets and said, oh no, it's down to these two guys.
Right.
Now, plenty of other scoop sites can say whatever they want, because if they're wrong, nobody gives a shit. But for Variety, they actually, it matters if they're wrong. So I feel like they would not have.
Oh, and it matters even more if they're wrong about this.
Right.
I mean, they've been wrong about stuff before, but you don't get the new Batman wrong.
No, God, no.
Right. Someone else got that wrong a few months ago. That was funny.
Yeah.
So Variety came out. They said Robert Pattinson is in final negotiations to play Batman. Again, yep. Deadline said no, Nicholas Holt is still in the running. And so
one of two things happened.
Yeah.
Okay, so Variety ran the report first, and then several minutes later Deadline ran theirs. So it could just be the petty stuff that does happen between the trades sometimes, where somebody else got out scooped and so they try to throw a little water on the other person's scoop. So that could be Deadline just trying to do that to not give Variety full credit for being the ones to break the story. You know, maybe one of the biggest casting stories that you're going to have all year, arguably the biggest casting story. So there's that. Or if there are negotiations and Robert Pattinson is dragging his feet, then if you're Warner Brothers, and Justin Kroll in his report on Variety said Warner Brothers did not confirm what he was reporting, so he, according to him, he's getting it from elsewhere. So if Warner Brothers is in final negotiations with Robert Pattinson and they're wanting to pressure him into signing, not the worst idea in the world to send a note to Deadline saying, hey, this other guy's still in the running too. We haven't made up our mind yet.
It's not like they haven't used someone for leverage in a Batman movie before.
The old Jack Nicholson, Robin Williams play.
Yeah, stuff like that does happen. I'm not saying that absolutely did happen in this case, but maybe that's what's at play here. I believe Robert Pattinson is Batman, and I'm going to be very surprised if that turns out not to be the case.
Yeah, I feel exactly the same way. I feel like that is what's going to happen. I got the impression that Deadline had some oldish, you know, some that oldish info, and they weren't ready to put all their money on Pattinson, and they're like, but yeah, I also think it could be a little bit of a, oh, slow down, Variety, here's what we know, that kind of thing.
Yep.
But yeah, I feel like at this point, if it's anyone but Robert Pattinson, I would be shocked. And that's not because I don't love Nicholas Holt, because I do love Nicholas Holt. But I just think that it seems like that's what's going to happen. And what's crazy is that this was a rumor that got a little bit of a smoke maybe a month or two ago, where the name first sort of floated up. And at that point, I was a little surprised to hear the name. It wasn't one that I thought of. But even then, when we discussed it on this show, and that one, Jamie, was there, as I was like, hey, man, Robert Pattinson is a good actor. If that comes to pass, I got no problem with it. And now that it seems like that is what's coming to pass, I still got no problem with it. I think he's a good actor. I think that he is youngish, so that way they can get multiple films out of him. I think he's tall. I think he's got range. I think, you know, you put a little bit of extra meat on the bones, and I think he'd be a great Batman. So I have no concerns about this. Brendan, how are you feeling about Robert Pattinson?
Oh, you're talking crazy talk, man. Have you seen the internet? You're totally wrong.
I know. I'm good at that.
Look, honestly, I even put this on my personal page yesterday. Like, I'm not someone who, I don't really know Robin Pattinson's work that well. I'll be the first to say the name Twilight. I tried watching the first one when it came out in what, 2008, whatever it was. It was a struggle. It just, they weren't for me. They weren't great movies in my opinion, but hey, they made a shit ton of money and have a huge fan base, but it's not my thing. But I'm also someone to say that was a decade ago. Like, there's been a lot of time between Twilight and now, and not that I've seen them, but I do know that he's put in quality work between now and then. Like, he's sort of become one of those, like, I don't want to say an actor's actor, but he's garnished a lot of respect in the industry for the stuff that he's done.
And here's the thing, is him doing Twilight, and I saw one, maybe two of them. Number one, he wasn't bad in those movies. I don't think they were good movies, but he wasn't bad in them. But Twilight has allowed him to spend the last 10 years or whatever it's been doing whatever the hell he wants, because he doesn't need to work for a paycheck anymore. Because Twilight's got him set for life.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like Daniel Radcliffe in the way that, you know...
Yeah, we all want that freedom, right? You know?
Yeah, he stops being Harry Potter and goes and plays, what, like a farting zombie or something in, like, his first, you know, non-Potter movie, whatever it was. But, yeah, I'm with you. I don't have a problem with it. He's a great actor. He very much looks the aesthetic from the description we've been given of, you know, what this Batman is going to be. He fits that age perfectly. He's got the jaw. Put a bit of meat on him, and you've got a youngish Bruce Wayne. I think he'll be really good. I'm along for the ride.
Sweet. And Sean, where are you on this?
I've got a scorching hot take on this. So if you are okay, listening with headphones, you may want to remove them so you don't burn your ears. Robert Pattinson may be a good Batman, or he may not. We'll find out in June 2021. I'm pretty confident in this casting. I like Robert Pattinson a lot. It's not his fault that you've only seen Twilight from his body of work.
Yeah.
That's not on him. And I'm not trying to say you're a bad movie fan if you've only seen the Twilight movies. A lot of the stuff that he's been up to for the past decade has been very small, independent things. But his career path actually reminds me a bit of a career path of somebody else that a lot of people freaked out over, and then became a once-in-a-generation performance with Heath Ledger. So in the same way that Robert Pattinson rose to fame via teen melodrama with Twilight, and you can't blame him for leaning into, as he was supposed to, being a melodramatic vampire in a movie about melodramatic vampires and werewolves. He just did the part. Mm-hmm. And he took the job at an age where any actor would have taken that job.
Oh, are you kidding? It was like one of the most coveted roles in Hollywood history. Yeah,
exactly. So
who wouldn't take that gig?
Exactly. I would have taken the gig. I was too old on it, but I would have taken it. Like, I would have been the Ian Ziering of Twilight if they would have had me. Like, I would have done it. But like, with Robert Pattinson, his career path, in the same way that, like, Heath Ledger coming off of 10 Things I Hate About You could have made a career the rest of his life doing just rom-coms, like, just no problem. Could have leaned into that whole thing, done teen rom-coms and then other rom-coms when he got older. Robert Pattinson could have coasted off of Twilight the entire time, but he didn't do that. He could have just stayed one of the biggest and most famous actors in Hollywood, trying to look for more star vehicles for himself, but he didn't do that. He made it about the work. He went and he challenged himself to do all kinds of different things. There's a movie he made a couple years ago, a crime thriller called Good Time, and he's outstanding in that. If you want something that's darker but not melodramatic in a Twilight sort of way, if you want something a little more serious, check that out. It's actually on Amazon Prime right now. You don't have to spend any money to rent the movie. If you have Prime, you can watch that movie. He's great in it. So Robert Pattinson is an outstanding actor. While you weren't watching, he's gone on to become one of the more impressive talents that Hollywood has. And there's a phrase that used to be kicked around a lot. I know it's been a while for Batman fans, but there's a phrase that used to be kicked around called Trust Nolan. Well, who did Nolan just cast to star in his next event movie? Robert Pattinson.
Very true.
If Robert Pattinson is good enough for Christopher Nolan, then he's good enough to have at least a minimal amount of faith from the Batman faithful that this guy can turn in a great performance. Now, it's not a guarantee. Matt Reeves is going to have something to do with how good Robert Pattinson does or doesn't look as Batman, obviously. But just at the mere mention of this guy and his name, he's bringing talent to the table. He's bringing, obviously, a work ethic to the table. He's bringing a certain level of artistry to the table, because he didn't just go for the easiest Hollywood path. So I think he's set himself up to be ready for this role. And so I'm excited to see what he's going to do with it. Doesn't mean it's going to turn out to be great. We won't know until we see it. But I'm as confident as I can be in this casting, and I'm as confident in Robert Pattinson as a name for the new Batman as I would be any other actor they could have put in this spot.
Yeah, I mean, and you bring up a great point about the fact that, you know, he has challenged himself to kind of work, you know, on the outskirts instead of just trying to do blockbusters or franchises. He's challenged himself to do a lot of other things. Mm-hmm. And so to bring him back into a franchise world, there's got to be something really compelling about this project to him, right, too. So that makes me very intrigued as to what was the pitch. What was Matt Reeves's pitch to him as to why, here's why you want to sign up for, you know, one of what will be the most heavily scrutinized role of your career. Here's why you want to be the next Batman, and here's what we're going to do together. I would love to have been in that room.
Oh, absolutely. And I think that's a great point about the state of this script. I know it's been a point of conversation again, because Justin Kroll, the same person who, you know, reported this news for Variety, also had a tweet a week or so ago about the script still being worked for the Batman, and maybe that resulting in production starting a little bit later than anticipated for later on this year. But it still isn't at a point where it's going to affect the release date. But this tells you that whatever state the script is in, it must be pretty good, because Robert Pattinson doesn't need this. He's already, mm-hmm. he's got a career for himself. He's starring in Nolan's next movie, or he's one of the stars of Nolan's next movie. So he doesn't need to be Batman right now. And it would only be natural, if we're being honest with ourselves and the current state of things and how things didn't necessarily go the way that most of us would have wanted for Ben Affleck as Batman, not even the way that Ben Affleck would have wanted it to go when he signed on to be Batman, it would only be natural for Robert Pattinson to have some reservations to say, is Batman going to be the right thing for me? Mm-hmm. Is this the right time for me to take on this role? Because you're right, you can't name a superhero role that is going to bring more scrutiny, as evidenced by the reaction just in the last 24 hours.
Right.
There's not going to be any role that brings more scrutiny with it than the role of Batman. So for Robert Pattinson to be willing to sign up for all that, and I'm sure he's smart enough to know that all of that comes with it, that's part of the package mm-hmm. deal. It just is. So for him to say, with all of that, I'm going to sign on for this anyway, that points to probably him having a strong interest in this character, but more specifically, a really strong passion. And he must have been impressed by what Matt Reeves is putting on the table.
Yeah, absolutely. And as you said, I have no reason to doubt him and no reason to not give him the benefit of the doubt. One thing that's been discussed, and I said it, I think Brendan said it as well, but is we all picture him from 10 years ago when he was really, really skinny. Mm-hmm. He's not that skinny anymore.
No.
Not the way he was, you know, in his Twilight heyday. But at the same time, like, it's not that hard to put on a little extra muscle. But also, just him becoming the new Batman doesn't mean he has to be a tank like Affleck was.
Right.
There's nothing wrong with being a more agile and live Batman, as opposed to the big powerhouse that we saw with Ben Affleck.
Right.
It's okay for Batman to have, you know, a little variety in his body type. You see it depending on who's drawing him. There's no reason in the films it can't be the same way. Because I have seen a little bit of that, of being like, okay, I guess he's a good actor, but he better put on 100 pounds. And I'm like, I don't think it needs to go that far. I mean, he'll tone up and whatnot, but Batman is an acrobat as well, so.
Everyone love Michael Keaton. I don't recall him putting on a shitload of muscle for the role.
Nope.
No, you can. Yeah. So he will hit the gym, but he does not need to become Ben Affleck to sell this role. I think, I think he's already almost there, because, you know, it's funny because some of the photos that people shared, some you look at and you're like, yeah, of course I don't see Batman in that because they're sharing Edward Cullen. But you see some of the more recent ones of him in a suit with, you know, the darker hair, and he's filled out just a little bit more. And you go, I feel like you're already almost there. You know, like you're it's a lot easier to see. So
that's what I was going to say. Like, when the rumor came out a couple of months ago, I did a little bit of Googling and some image searches and stuff, and I was just like, damn, he cuts a dashing figure. Like, he looks like he could be that Playboy millionaire.
Absolutely.
You know, he looks the part. He definitely does.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
And I'm someone who hated Twilight, you know?
So yeah.
It's just like, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, my thing with Twilight...
To be perfectly clear, I am not a Twilight fan.
Yeah, yeah.
My point is that Robert Pattinson's done a whole lot more.
Sure, sure. And my whole thing with Twilight is, I'm like, that was never made for me. Like, I just, no. like it's just, that's not even in my sphere. It's not my problem. I don't care. Like, so, like they weren't making that series for Andy DiGenova, and that's fine. Like, I am not going to
make it for my mother.
Yeah, I'm not going to use that franchise that wasn't for me to prejudge this actor taking on the role of Batman. You know, like, that's just, to me, those are two separate issues.
Who would do a thing like that, though?
Twilight gave, I want to point this out, Twilight gave us Anna Kendrick, and we should all be freaking thankful because she's a national treasure.
Well, that's 100% accurate. So
yes, so
at
thank
this point
you,
we owe it to Twilight to gamble our next Batman on Robert Pattinson anyway.
Absolutely.
But it's not that much of a gamble because he's a good actor. And regarding his his body type, no, he doesn't have Ben Affleck's frame. He's not going to bulk up to that level, but to your point, he just doesn't need to. Ben Affleck is the first Batman that ever had that body type, really.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Bale got pretty big for Batman Begins, but he didn't get that big again for Dark Knight or Dark Knight Rises, and that didn't hurt his portrayal of Batman one bit. And also, one of the things we've heard consistently, and I think based on Robert Pattinson's age, this backs it up, that we've heard consistently this is going to be a younger Batman. Not necessarily an origin Batman, but a younger Batman. And what's the most famous story about a young Batman? It's year one. Is Batman a behemoth in year one? Nope. He's pretty lean. So I think if we're having a younger Batman story, Robert Pattinson with a little bit of muscle, just give him some protein shakes and let him hit the weights a little bit, and he'll be fine. He'll be exactly what he needs to be for Batman, and I think he'll look just fine in the role. And as we've seen multiple times now, it's so funny within Batman fandom to have this kind of stuff happen over and over and over again when we can keep pointing out how this happens over and over and over again.
It's amazing how we don't learn.
That the fandom freaks out. Yeah, the fandom freaks out every time, and every time they're wrong. I mean, it's just whether you go Michael Keaton, well, Christian Bale was fine, but even Ben Affleck had his share of detractors when he was first announced, and you know, he won a lot of people over. So we see this happen again and again. Heath Ledger as the Joker, Anne Hathaway as Catwoman. We see this stuff all the time, and then these actors come in, and what do? They act.
They do their job.
Yeah, exactly. They do their damn job, and they do it pretty well. And Robert Pattinson, if you've seen anything outside of Twilight, and if you haven't, go watch something. You will see that this guy has a ton of talent. He has the range that is needed to play the multiple facets of this role. The real Bruce Wayne, the Playboy Bruce Wayne, Batman. I mean, he has it all. He can do all of these things. If the story's there for Matt Reeves, and obviously we know when it comes to direction, Matt Reeves is going to bring it. I feel like this is going to be a really good team.
And the other thing is, too, don't forget he's a Brit, and Brits have a pretty good history of superhero roles.
They've done okay.
Throw
Andrew Garfield back at you, but you know, this is not but Robert Pattinson's better than that.
Yeah. He's good at all the stuff.
That's true.
It amazes me how, I mean, we've learned, the three of us, I mean, but how many have not learned? Like, how many times have we gone through this with how many superheroes? It's like, and it turned out fine or great. It's just amazing.
Yeah, we didn't even need the internet to have a meltdown about Batman casting with Michael Keaton. So
right,
yeah, this whole pattern, it's older than Twitter, much older than the internet. But we just don't come around and start doing better with this kind of stuff.
It's crazy. So I'm on board for it. I think it's going to be great. Again, if Matt Reeves is into it and Robert Pattinson is into it, I am into it too. And I look forward to seeing what they're bringing. But Robert Pattinson, as our new Batman, he needs somebody to punch in the face, right? Like, he can't just, you know, it can't just be him brooding in a truck in the woods, because that's
metaphorically, he'll be punching all these doubters in the face in 2 years, but that's it.
But just to, 12, 18 hours after we learned that he is probably our new Batman, we got another little report, and this one came from the Hollywood Reporter about the Matt Reeves Batman script, and they reported that there will be a half a dozen Batman villains in the film.
It's at least two, up to half a dozen.
Okay. At least two. Do you want to read it? Do you have it in front of you?
Yeah. This is what Hollywood Reporter actually wrote in their Heat Vision blog for Friday. Matt Reeves is still tweaking his script, which is rumored to have at least two villains, the Penguin being one of them, according to sources. One person is telling us there will be around half a dozen villains. We're hearing of another perfect character making an appearance in the script as well. Perfect spelled P-U-R-R-F-E-C-T. So obviously Catwoman. So they're saying Penguin and Catwoman as two villains, but up to half a dozen villains in the film.
Right. And that lines up with things that we had heard in the past. You know, there had been certain things teased and rumors floated that Matt Reeves was going to use more than just one or two of the villains. We've heard the Penguin floated around a lot over the past
Penguin's
year.
Been around for a long time.
Yep.
Yeah. And so there was also when Collider kind of summarized, they also mentioned a rumor of the Riddler. It wasn't in the Hollywood Reporter, but that's out there as another rumor as well. So this is exciting times, you know, just seeing some movement and starting to get a little detail here. So Penguin and Catwoman, and then possibly filled out with some other villains as well. Brendan, how you feel?
Look, I'm feeling great about it. I'm very excited at the thought of having an established Rogues Gallery and expanded Batman universe, because it's not something we've ever had before in the live action movies, particularly not one straight out of the gate where it's a rebooted version. Like, these villains in not just Batman movies, but essentially all comic book movies, they tend to conveniently come one after the other. It's like, you know, they only have room for so many in a certain story. But I mean, it's the reason why I love stories like Hush so much. It's why I love the animated movies so much, because they can put these, you know, multiple villains in to give us that real expanded Batman world. And that's what I've been craving in live action for a really long time. And the thought that that's what we're going to get is really damn exciting.
Yeah. I mean, I great points all around. And that is something that I feel like we have not gotten. It is many Batman movies as we have gotten over the years. We have not gotten one that has been fully populated with the Rogues Gallery and with the world of Batman. Like you said, we get, like, you know, one at a time. It's like there's another one waiting in the wings who's like, well, I can't reveal myself until he defeats this guy. That's just the way it goes.
Have we ever had more than three?
No.
I think three's kind of been your max.
Yeah, I don't know. I can't, not that I can think of. So anyway, I mean, I agree with all that. I love the idea of getting to set up many of them that you can then exploit in sequels or not. But just to know that they are out there is pretty awesome and pretty exciting. Sean, how are you feeling about Penguin and Catwoman and then whoever else might show up?
I really do hope it's more villains than Penguin and Catwoman, because we had that movie once. So I don't want just that duo from the Batman Rogues Gallery. I'm very excited for Penguin to come back, because Penguin,
it's time.
It's very much time. And the take that we had in Batman Returns was a very specific take. And I don't, for a lot of people who don't like that take and criticize it for not being like mob boss Penguin or whatever, that take predates most of the mob boss Penguin stuff. So you can't really fault
it for that. Thank you. Thank you. That's been my point for years.
So anyway, like, it was Tim Burton's swing at saying, we got to do something different with Penguin. And yes, he took his swing, and you can like it or leave it. But point being, this character has grown a lot in the source material in the many years since Batman Returns. And we haven't really had an opportunity to see that reflected in live action. And so let's do it. I mean, this movie is going to come out almost 30 years after Batman Returns, which I don't even want to do the math on how old I am. that's sad. Now I'm going to start crying. But I certainly want to see an updated take on the Penguin in a live action Batman movie. Absolutely. Catwoman, we've already had a couple takes on that as recently as 2012, although that'll be 9 years since Rises when this comes out. but I don't need that as much. I mean, I'll take it. I'll be excited to watch it, but I don't feel that same sense of urgency around seeing that character again as I obviously do for the Penguin. So there are a lot of other characters that I feel a sense of urgency for, and so that's why I do like the idea, and I hope this comes to fruition. that we are going to see several villains in this story. And I know that there's long been this negative connotation of the idea of multiple villains in a story. And I know that's gone badly in other films, but it always comes down to balance. You don't necessarily have to have every villain play a major role in the story. I mean, you go through, Brennan brought up the example of Hush, but there's also The Long Halloween, and that's more of a noir detective kind of story. It's actually my favorite Batman comic book story. And we know that Matt Reeves is going for, he's talked about having a noir detective driven kind of story. And so that could just mean Batman, over the course of an investigation in this movie, encounters different villains along the way. It's not necessarily that they're all in on the same plot in a penguin submarine. It doesn't have to necessarily be that. If it is,
but they can. I'm not gonna complain about it.
Yeah, I'm not saying they shouldn't do it. I'm just saying it won't necessarily be what they do.
They just need a six-sided periscope instead of four.
Look, if box office grosses show anything, like, people love movies where other people turn to dust. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, that's true. So, like, I'm up for it. And I think it all comes down to how you handle it. I'm sure that Matt Reeves understands that there's only so much real estate in a story to make sure that, you know, and he'll pick and choose which villains are going to get the most of that real estate based on how central they are to the plot. And other people might just have glorified cameos. But I'm here for it because, as you've both mentioned, we've never had it. We've never had Batman, whether it's in his early years or his prime, with an established or at least somewhat established rogues gallery where some of these people are just around and you just encounter them, because that's how Batman comics are. I mean, so many times this story, it's not the Batman versus Joker story, but Joker pops up for some reason, or it is a Batman versus Joker story, but Riddler shows up for some reason, or Batman stops by the Iceberg Lounge and there's Penguin. Like, I love that about Batman comic books. I love that the world exists. And there's nothing there really hasn't been a way, or that anybody's really attempted to bring that to the big screen. And so if Matt Reeves is trying to do that in any way, shape, or form, I'm up for seeing how he plans to execute it. So the mere mention of Catwoman is sort of exciting, not that exciting, but Penguin, very exciting. And the idea of half a dozen rogues. So even if I get Penguin and Catwoman, I might get four other villains that I haven't seen in a very long time or ever on the big screen. I can't help but be excited by that.
No, I mean, here, I'm with you on all that. I think that, you know, as we mentioned, Penguin is just way overdue. He's someone that a lot of fans wanted to see pop up in the Nolan trilogy, and that just didn't ever come to pass. And so, the last time we saw him in a big screen movie was in 1992. Yes, we've seen him on TV and whatnot, but he's ripe for a new big screen interpretation. And as you said, the character has evolved a lot in the past almost 30 years, and you can give us a brand new take on the Penguin in a movie. So I think that is exciting, and I think it's about time, and so I'm good with that. Catwoman, I will always take more Catwoman, but you're right. It's not like we've been starving for Catwoman content. The off-handed rumor about the Riddler gets me most excited because, like the Penguin, I really wanted Nolan to have fun with the Riddler, and that just didn't happen either. And I think the Riddler, he is due for some big screen redemption as well. Totally. So I'm excited for Penguin, but like not as excited as I would be for like Riddler or Mr. Freeze. But this whole half a dozen thing allows me the opportunity to hope for all of those as well. Because as you say, if we go with six, if we say there's going to be six, it's not like, all six are going to converge and make a deal and team up, but it's okay to check in with them. Right. That's what we've said for years is the Penguin doesn't have to be the big bad, but it is super easy in a Batman story for Batman to check in with the Penguin at the Iceberg Lounge and press him for information. It's the easiest thing to do, and it's great. And so I love the idea of having these guys everywhere. I think the key will be, and this is what I truly hope will happen, is if he's got a good sampling of the rogues gallery scattered throughout the film, and then whoever rises to the top and becomes the main antagonist or antagonists, cool. Whatever works for what Matt Reeves has got planned is great. But even if they are just cameos or extended cameos, I want you to get great actors for all of them.
Absolutely.
Yep.
So you can exploit them in sequels. So even if in this one, the Riddler, it's a one scene cameo where the Riddler, you know, screws with Batman's head, gives him false clues, whatever. Give me a great actor who can continue that character in future films if the Riddler's going to take center stage. Like, and you need to do that for all of them, because that's going to give you a lot more storytelling options for future films. Because you know they're not, you know they're thinking past one movie. Come on.
Oh, 100%.
So cast accordingly. Like, don't cast a nobody and then have to recast later. Unless that nobody is really amazing and who's going to, you know, blow up and be great in future films. But I love this approach. You know, this is kind of what I was hoping for. I hope this is true. Penguin and Catwoman, great. They're mainstays. And so happy to see new versions of them. But I'm even more excited to hear who the other four might be. Please be Riddler.
I mean, the only thing I would assume is, and maybe it won't prove to be a safe assumption, I'm going to guess one of them isn't Joker. I feel like that's the character.
I feel the same way.
And it's not a bad thing. You know, we've seen plenty of Joker, and I say that as somebody who, I mean, I love Batman because I loved Joker first. So I mean, like, that, I love that character so much, and it's not that I would ever get tired of seeing him, but we've seen a lot. Audiences, general audiences have seen a lot. And so I think the idea of, cause you can always bring him in. You can always bring him in. You don't even need setup for the Joker. You can just bring him in whenever you want. So there's no need to push him into Matt Reeves' first film. He also has a tendency to overshadow everybody else. So that's another reason why you would keep him out if you were going to have a movie with potentially six villains. And I know he popped up in Long Halloween and Hush, but if you were going to have a movie with potentially six villains, if Joker's one of the six, then he becomes the only one of the six people are talking about walking out of the movie. And I think you want him, as you said, Andy, if they do the casting right, I feel like that's part of the point of there being, if there are six like name villains in this movie, I feel like part of the reason for that would be setting up future movies. And I could totally see it being a swerve where Batman thinks he's solved a crime by the end of this, and he has, but then he realizes that the case runs much deeper, and one of the villains that he talked to for maybe 5 minutes actually ends up being the real culprit behind the bigger thing here. And that's a whole thing setting up the second film, or that it's going to be, that's going to be the story that carries through into a second and third film potentially. So yeah, I think the whole point of these, you know, the multiple villain approach here is to make this feel more like the established Batman world that fans have loved in comic books, loved in Arkham games and Batman animation and all those kinds of things, but just never had. With the live action movie franchise, and it was never gonna happen unless you hit the fast forward button like this, right? Because if you do because how many times is a director, or how many films is a director really gonna make? They're gonna make up to three, and then they're gonna move on because they want to do other things. And these movies take 2 to 3 years a pop just to, out of a director's life. So if we're always having to do three films and then reboot, we're just never gonna get the rogues gallery. So let's just throw them in at once and then work with it and then just work.
Amen. Yeah, absolutely.
It's the only way to make it happen, in the, at least in movies. You can do it if they want to have one day a massively budgeted, not Gotham budget, like Game of Thrones budget Batman show on the Warner streaming service, which is not a bad idea, and I'm totally in favor of it. But movies are next for Batman, and Batman's still on the big screen, and let's get the world in there, and that includes the rogues gallery. Throw them in there, just balance it in the script so they're not stepping on each other, and that everybody gets the amount of time they need to have in the story, and that and they properly service the story. As long as we do that, get them all in there so that way we can explore some of these characters in greater detail in the subsequent films.
Because it doesn't even need to be a Batman sequel as well. Like, if you do this next series of movies right, and you start introducing your Robins, your Nightwings and stuff like that, you've then already got villains cast for like potential Nightwing movie, Batgirl, whatever. Like, they're there. The villains are there.
Totally.
Yeah, absolutely.
If they give Josh Gad this job, I'm sure he would show up for a Nightwing movie.
I was just gonna say, I haven't looked at his Twitter since this rumor came out. So how's that going?
He definitely tweeted out a little joke. Yeah, he tweeted out
like, "I could take him" or something.
Yeah, like he tweeted out the Robert Pattinson thing, saying, "I could take him." Yeah, which is pretty funny. But no, I mean, and that's exactly it, is you can definitely still have a larger Batman world with whatever they're setting up here. Something I've always thought, and I thought about it with the X-Men films, I thought about the Spider-Man films, and you could even do it here, is I always thought like it was a wasted opportunity because nobody's really done it where you have an opening sequence where it's Batman versus a villain.
Yep.
And he defeats him, locks him up in Arkham, and it's like the prelude to the movie.
Dude,
and
so it's cold open.
It's the Bond, exactly. The James Bond.
I've been saying that for years.
Yeah,
do that with comic book movies.
Exactly, like for X-Men, I was like, why did this not open with them taking out the Juggernaut, and then we kick into the movie, like, or Spider-Man, it's such an easy thing that nobody's really taken advantage of for superhero movies. I would say maybe like the Winter Soldier with Batroc, like something like that. You know, like that's a perfect example of when they did that. But there's no reason Batman couldn't do that. Is, you know, the opening sequence to introduce us to our new Batman is him taking out Clayface, or him taking out the Scarecrow, or the Mad Hatter, or whoever.
Yeah, I mean, the closest we ever got was the Dark Knight. After the prologue, we get Batman taking down the Scarecrow, but we had already seen the Scarecrow in that world. Now, to be clear, I love that Cillian Murphy is in all three movies in Nolan's trilogy.
So totally. Yeah.
In hindsight, I wouldn't trade it. But going into the Dark Knight, that was something that I wanted, was let's just so Nolan can touch another villain. Mm-hmm. Let's have an opening action sequence where Batman catches up with somebody before he inevitably goes in and takes down the Joker. And again, we sort of got it with Scarecrow, but if there was a way to work in another character, that would have been a lot of fun. But that is definitely something they should do with one of the, if they're going to have half a dozen villains, they can spare one for a cold open.
Right. And especially for someone who's never going to be the main villain, you know,
right.
Matt Hatter, that's a perfect example that like, yeah, you can introduce him, have a cool sequence, but he's not going to be the star of the show, and that's okay.
Right.
Move on. So no, I love it. And I'm excited about everything I'm hearing, which is great. I do want to get your guys' thoughts on this, because there'd been a little conversation I had seen between fans about this of how this Batman, I mean, I have my opinions, but I want to get yours, is how this Batman fits into the DC universe continuity or not. You know, because there had been previous rumors that this takes place 20 years in the past. So do you think that they will, you know, imply that, oh, maybe it's still Ben Affleck's Batman, but we're just, you know, like you can make that your headcanon. I don't know. What do you guys think?
Sean, you want to go?
I would say that I don't think they will immediately do anything that says that this cannot be Ben Affleck's Batman, but I don't think they will go out of their way to make it definitive that this is Ben Affleck's Batman. I mean, I still feel like it's going to be set, though, in the present. And I feel like Warner Brothers is kind of in this weird spot. And I know this will just scare the crap out of everybody, and I've been saying it, but I'll keep saying it. I kind of think the DC timeline is an X-Men timeline where some stuff is canon and some stuff isn't. And we're taking what we want and we're leaving the rest. And so, I don't know, maybe they will do something that shows that this is not the Ben Affleck Batman. But I feel like the only way to really do that is to make it absolutely clear at what point in time relative to the rest of the DCEU this is taking place. But I think the only project that, you know, there are only two projects. Either you will tie this in closer to Joker, which is supposed to be Elseworlds and not canon with anything. So I don't think they're going to do that. That would be setting it in the past.
Mm-hmm.
But how close is this to Birds of Prey? You know, Birds of Prey is going to be out next year. They already shot it. So that's something that if Robert Pattinson is contemporary with Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn, well, then that points to the fact that Ben Affleck's Batman is no longer canon. And there's not, you know, it's not connected to that portion of the DCEU, but I still don't know that they'll do anything in any overt way to prove one way or another. So I think at least through the first movie, everybody's going to be allowed to have whatever headcanon they want. And then depending on the shape of the broader DCEU or just the smaller Batman portion of the universe, maybe by the second film, we'll have a better idea of exactly where this is fitting in a timeline and what that means for whether or not Ben Affleck's Batman is still part of it. So right now, I guess, say enjoy your headcanon however you prefer. And maybe, you know, maybe you'll be allowed to keep that through at least all the way, perhaps all the way through this first film. So maybe you're safe until 2023, 2024.
Okay. Brendan, where do you fall?
Yeah, I haven't given it a hell of a lot of thought, to be honest, but I don't know. I know it sounds like a really cliche thing, but as long as the movie's good, I don't really care. Like, I know, I can't remember if we've discussed it on the show or if it's just been like in our group chat that we have. Like, I wouldn't care if the you know, quote unquote DCEU stuff was over there, you know, with Wonder Woman and Aquaman and Shazam and whatever doing their own thing. That wouldn't bother me. I also, we were saying before with the extended Batman universe and like the world he lives in, I wouldn't mind if it was its own thing. And if it becomes very popular and successful, have a Batman universe, do a Nightwing movie, do a Batgirl movie and set it in this world. The DC continuity, as much as it annoys me, it is a mess. It could go either way, like Sean was saying, it depending on how everything plays out, but I'm not going to be disappointed if it doesn't, you know, carry on that this is Ben Affleck's Batman in the past. And I won't be disappointed if they do find a good way of tying it all in. I'll go, okay, cool, that makes sense. Let's go. One way or the other, as long as the movies we're seeing are good, I really don't care that much about the continuity.
Yeah, my question is, it's less about what I want it to be, because I'm with you, like, it's going to be what it's going to be. But what I think it's going to be is I think that, you know, Matt Reeves has been given the creative freedom to do what he wants. And so I think that this is going to be whatever movie he wants it to be. So I think that means we are starting from scratch as far as what the bat suit's going to be, what the Batmobile's going to be, what the Batcave's going to be, who Alfred's going to be, who Jim Gordon's going to be. Like, I think that all of that probably is going to be unique to this film. I do not think there will be any overt ties to the greater DCEU, but I also don't think there will be any contradictions.
Right.
It'll just be its own thing. And if you want to say, oh yeah, yeah, that's the Batman we already saw, but 20 years ago, you can do that, because there'll be nothing in the movie that tells you that's not true. But I also don't think they're going to put in Jeremy Irons and J.K. Simmons and then you go, oh, well, yeah, it's the same Batman. Yeah. I think it's going to be its own little thing. And kind of as I sort of led the witness at the beginning, is I think that it's going to allow the people who want that headcanon to say it's all the same, to allow them to do that if they want to. That's what I think it will be.
Yeah. And I do think that, you know, I'm trying to think of how they'll approach it, because inevitably in interviews, they're just going to be asked, is this in the timeline with Ben Affleck's Batman? And I'll be interested to see what they say regarding that, because the safest approach is to try and be as vague as possible with where it fits in the timeline. So that way they don't upset anybody who wants it to be in the timeline. And so I'm not sure how they'll do that. It almost reminds me of the Incredible Hulk.
That's exactly what I was about to say. Yeah.
2008, yeah. Leading into 2008.
Totally.
They were like, well, we're kind of starting it out, but it's not a full reboot. It's kind of, you know, following the other movie, but yeah, not.
The first movie ends in South America. The second movie starts in South America. Exactly. So if you want it to be the same.
Except in that one, but that was more of the talk track. But then when you watch the movie, there's a completely different origin for Bruce Banner.
Yeah.
The prologue.
That's
so
right.
So it's like, oh yeah, it's not, this is a reboot. It's not an origin story, but it is a reboot. So I don't know, but I don't expect there to be anything like that. So in the way that Incredible Hulk had a very different visual cue for the origin to show you that this was not actually canon with Ang Lee's Hulk, and it never would have been with the whole Marvel Studios and MCU, whatever. I don't think the Batman is going to have that kind of thing that goes out of its way to say we have nothing to do with the other thing. But eventually we might reach that point. And that's why I say film two or film three, because, you know, at some point Warner Brothers just isn't going to care. And this movie doesn't need to be connected to the rest of the timeline. It doesn't need to be connected to Ben Affleck and his Batman, that story is never going forward. So you don't need to, you know, stress on continuing. And I know there are a lot of people who are still upset that that storyline is never going forward, but it doesn't change the fact that it's not going forward. So I feel like for the interest of not of minimizing the amount of upset fans, good luck. They're already mad because it's Robert Pattinson. But, you know, like to try and minimize the hurt feelings, they'll try and allow people to preserve their headcanon. But, you know, so think what you want. But I don't think they're going out of their way to make sure that this looks like it's attached.
No, I don't think so either. And I think that there's a great point there is that if this movie was completely insular, you could get away with going either way, but the parts that complicate it is things like Birds of Prey, and if you know, if the Batgirl movie happens, and you know, that's when things start getting complicated, because then what version of Gotham are those tied into,
right? Yeah, and would you never want, if things go well with Robert Pattinson's Batman, would you never want him to be able to cross paths with Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn? I certainly wouldn't want to take that option off the table if I were Warner Brothers. So, you know, you have to be open to that. But I don't think she's going to pop up in this movie, and so that's what makes it okay. But, you know, speaking of the Batman world, guess what comes out, you know, what, 5-6 weeks after the Batman is the Suicide Squad? You know, and that stars Harley Quinn again, so she's there. I mean, there's a lot of Batman characters and Batman-related characters that are going to be hovering around the time of the Batman's release date. You know, we're going to have like three within 18 months between Birds of Prey, the Batman, and Suicide Squad. So I don't, if they want to build a little mini Bat universe and have it be contemporary with Robert Pattinson's Batman, I mean, the opportunity is there. But obviously, there's the other part of this, which is in the same way that I think Matt Reeves, with his creative control, wouldn't want to, you know, have to go out of his way to check in with Wonder Woman or Aquaman. Maybe he also doesn't want to go out of his way to check in with Birds of Prey and Suicide Squad. So maybe he just would prefer those things be optional, like Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn, and not necessarily have to have direct connections in the film that almost create the fan demand of saying, look, you have to put these characters in these movies now because you've connected these other, you have to cross things over now. So it'll be interesting to see how it all unfolds. But I think Brendan's got the best point in all this. As long as the movie's good, you know, write up your own headcanon, put your own fan fiction on Tumblr. I don't care. I just want the movie to be great. And based on the pieces that we're hearing about, including Robert Pattinson as the star of this, at the center of it. And, you know, Andy, you and I, going back to when Matt Reeves was first in talks to be in this and then hired to direct it, you know, this was, you know, the top choice. After Ben Affleck bowed out, Matt Reeves was the guy, and he's still the guy. I know it's been a little frustrating because we've been waiting for so long for this thing to gain traction and get going. But, you know, we knew one big domino that had to fall was finding the new Batman. And if that what we found, then it's full speed ahead and let's go.
Yeah, we're here. Like, just with the continuity thing while you guys were talking, like, I started thinking, we mentioned it before, like, I obviously, everyone knows I'm a big Bond fan as well as I am a Batman fan. Like, pre-Daniel Craig era, there's 20 movies over 40 years that, realistically, it's meant to be the same character all the way through. But everyone else around him aged out or got recast. And, you know, there was maybe one or two things out of all of those movies that ever linked the character to say, yes, it's the same dude. But it doesn't make any sense. But you just watch each movie and go, yes, it's James Bond. That's the guy. Like, you know, it doesn't... Don't get me wrong, and this isn't a shot at Marvel, but it's one of those things now, because of those film success, that is just what people expect. Particularly with comic book movies now, and it doesn't have to be that way. And that's not a slight on movies that aren't part of an extended universe, nor is it a slight against the movies that are. Like, it can work both ways. It's, I mean, yeah, the DC stuff can be a little bit messy if all these movies are successful and people really want them to go together, but they don't have to. And that's not always a bad thing.
Well, and it does feel like Warner Brothers is starting to agree with you, you know, like their attempt to have very strong continuity from film to film to film wasn't working for them. And now they seem less dedicated to that and going, you know, each movie's its own thing. And make the movies that they want to make, and if they want to connect them, cool. But like they seems to have loosened up the reins on that a lot. And I think that's okay. You know, like there are franchises that are extremely continuity heavy, and it's, you know, it's Harry Potter, it's 8 movies, but it's one story or whatever, you know, but you know, there's Indiana Jones, it's 4 movies, 4 stories. And yeah, it's okay to take that approach. Or as you say, Bond, 8,000 movies, 8,000 right, stories. And neither is right or wrong. It's just different approaches, and that's okay.
Well, and I think to Brenna's point with the Bond series, that's how you can get a rogues gallery in Batman, not just by, you know, not just by hitting the fast forward button, as I was talking about getting 6 villains in there. But if we stop worrying so much about where and what timeline every single movie fits, like, and we don't have to reboot every time we change filmmakers and stuff, like, you know, or change who's playing Batman or whatever, that's how we can get more of a, you know, a more robust rogues gallery on the big screen. I mean, all of these kinds of things with continuity, you know, yes, the Marvel movies have been very successful with building out their timeline and building out the story and all of that. But, you know, the box office receipts show that a lot of people who are watching, you know, the biggest movies aren't watching everything. And so continuity doesn't, and continuity really hasn't hurt the X-Men franchise. It's not general moviegoers walking outside of the theater with the X-Men franchise being like, boy, that movie sure screwed up the timeline. They don't say any of that. They either liked the story or they didn't. And yeah, so, you know, these aren't the kinds of things that most people who watch these movies worry about. And so I think with Warner Brothers, you know, they can play it however they want, and they can decide what movies they want to stitch together at a later date. And I know that sounds crazy because, you know, we are conditioned to think of movie timelines in a certain way, especially with comic book films. But truth be told, if you go back to the source material, there's a lot of that stitching continuity, moving things in and out of continuity, retconning and all those things. It's part of the source material. So carrying that tradition forward to the films in some way, I think it's okay to do it. It's another approach, and I don't think it's necessarily going to hurt the films as long as the individual stories are great. And I guess maybe, you know, there's one point that I should have brought up in terms of how Warner Brothers is going to play this. Maybe they will play it as more of a reboot that has nothing to do with Ben Affleck's Batman, but I still don't know if I'll believe it, because, you know, the narrative for the Suicide Squad, including its title, is that this is not a sequel, except it's got the same Sam Harley Quinn, like the same biggest star of the original one. So I don't know. I think, you know, Warner Brothers will say one thing, but it ultimately will come down to what they actually do in the movies. And so we'll see what the Batman does, but I still don't see how this movie is going to really make a point to say that this is not, that this can't be connected to the other stuff. It doesn't mean it is, but I don't think they're going to rule that out for fans, at least not in the first film, unless of course Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn pops up out of nowhere, but I don't think that's going to happen. She seems pretty right, busy with other stuff right now, and you certainly don't want to overexpose that character.
For sure. And let me ask you this question, because think about it. You've got, right now, you've got a really strong Wonder Woman franchise going forward. Mm-hmm. You've got a really strong Aquaman franchise going forward. And let's say Matt Reeves' The Batman hits big. Are you telling me Warner Brothers isn't going to be tempted to go, well, maybe the three of them do meet up?
Right.
Like, you know, like if this new Batman hits big and people love him the way that they have taken to Gal Gadot's Wonder Woman, the way they've taken to Jason Momoa's Aquaman, you're telling me they're not going to be tempted to go, yeah, we know that they met Ben Affleck's Batman, but maybe this is just Batman now.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they will at least discuss it. Like, you know, like I just, and at that point it does get to the, yeah, well, we know, but maybe you'll like this, you know, this team up better. Yeah.
Well, if the Batman and the Suicide Squad are successful, the first thing that's going to give it away is that Wonder Woman 3 will be called The Wonder Woman. Then we'll get the Aquaman. And then, you know, that's when we'll start seeing signs that they're going to tie it all in together.
Yeah. Right, right.
For the Justice League.
The Shazam.
DC The Universe.
The DCTU?
Yes.
The Universe, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, well, it's exciting times. It is great after, you know, we've been very patient with Matt Reeves and Batman. And, you know, I know that we all want to open our Christmas presents early, but let's be patient. Christmas is coming. It will. But it is nice after waiting and just hearing, you know, they're working on the script. They're working on the script. They're working on the script. Great. It is nice to finally start getting some real news and some real movement on it. We've got a new Batman, we think we do.
And it's really well, and it's also really important that they take their time with this. I know normally when we just hear something being worked on forever and ever and ever, I know why we think it, because it's the way things often go, that the movie just never happens, you know, and eventually it just fizzles out. But in the case of this, I mean, it's been Matt Reeves on this job for close to 2 years. He didn't really start when he signed. Remember, he had to finish War for the Planet of the Apes and everything. So he was booked when he originally signed on for this job. So some of that time was just sunk. You were never going to get it. It was never going to be put into this film. But he's been on the job for coming up on 2 years. I think he's still a couple months shy of that. But he's been on the job for a little while. But you have to just look at the lay of the land. You're coming off of Justice League. You're coming off of Batman v Superman. And regardless of anyone's individual feelings about those films, we know that the Batman brand cinematically isn't in the greatest shape right this second, not in the best shape that it's ever been. And there has to be very real concern on the part of Warner Brothers that if we come out with our next solo Batman movie and it doesn't land, that we could be in as bad, if not worse, shape than we were in 1997 in terms of how long we would have to wait before we can take another shot with this character. You need to get this movie right. And as fans, regardless of what Warner Brothers needs, we just want the best possible film. So that should mean that we want them to get the movie right. And as always, it's more important to get the movie right than to get it right now. So if that means waiting 2 more years and even the latest round of, you know, a possible production delay, it's not at a point where it's affecting the release date. So there's really nothing to worry about. We have a new Batman. That's, you know, the first major piece that we've had since Matt Reeves was put in place. It's the biggest piece that we could have had after having a new director. Arguably, it's at an even bigger piece than the new director. So we have this in place. I think it's time to be happy. I think it's time to be excited. It's these kinds of things that take a movie from being just an idea that's just kind of out there in our, you know, in our headspace and as we're talking about it, and it allows it to be a little tangible. And I like that. I love it when movies start taking on that tangible quality. And that's what we have.
We need something tangible. Yes. Gordon's got a file on this. I can't even get him on the phone.
Yeah. So, it's important. Like, it is important. And this is a huge step to have a new Batman. And I know outrage is par for the course whenever there's a major Batman casting announcement. But I'm going to go ahead and rejoice on this one. I'm excited. Robert Pattinson's a really good actor being teamed up with a really good director. And last time that happened for us, that's usually worked out pretty well. For us as Batman fans, and I have no reason to expect that it won't.
You're right. Kilmer and Schumacher were awesome.
Brendan, why do you do this? Why do you do this?
Well, you know, Nolan and Bale, not bad.
Yeah. No, you're right. I see what you're going for there.
Not bad.
But no, I mean, and it is true. And I was just more acknowledging the patience the fans have had, or, you know, some of the fans haven't been so patient. Yeah. Just acknowledging it and knowing, you know, it's paying off, guys. Yep. It's paying off now, because now things are starting to come together. We got a release date. Now we have a Batman. We're starting to hear about villains. The train is moving, and that's something to be excited about. Our patience is about to pay off. So, you know, just be patient a bit longer, and these little goodies are going to start coming our way, and that's super awesome. There is a new Batman coming, and I can't freaking wait, but I will wait, because as Sean said, it's more important to get it right than to get it right now.
But the other thing is, yes, it's coming out in 2 years' time. That, you know, that seems like a long time, but I don't know about you guys, but I've really been following this stuff,
it's not long at all.
It goes fast.
Yeah, but these next 2 years, this is the exciting part. Like, yeah, going to see the movie on opening day is really cool. And, you know, you can only have that experience once, though, and it'll last maybe 2 hours. We have 2 years of excitement in front of us right now. Like, every little thing is going to be exciting. Trailers, more casting.
Absolutely.
Soundtrack. artwork, photos, it's all coming. And that's the part I love about these movies, sometimes more than the movie themselves. It's I don't look always look back on the movie. I look back on the journey that got us there.
Absolutely.
Well, I mean, and think about leading up to Batman versus Superman, like the announcement of Ben Affleck, getting that first photo of Ben Affleck, getting that first photo of the Batmobile, you know, like all of those moments where they were like, oh my God, like, ah, this is what the new Batman is. We get to do all that again. And that's the fun shit. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I remember kids in Chicago in 2004 uploading a video of them watching filming from a parking structure, Batman on a roof for the during production on Batman Begins, saying, "Holy ish, it's effing Batman." Mm-hmm. Like, and I can remember everything from the build up to the Dark Knight and the Dark Knight Rises. Like, it's Brennan, you're totally right. There's a part of me, the movies are the top thing. I love to have the movies and watch them and talk about them and everything. But
and you have them forever. This doesn't last.
Exactly. The buildup is such a huge part of it. And I'm always, always a little bit sad when that's over.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I will relish these next 2 years. And if you think that's a long time, trust me, from personal experience, in 30 years, there's going to be three guys on a podcast talking about how it's been almost 30 years since the Batman hit theaters and they last saw the Penguin. So, like, it's going to go by really, really fast.
Oh, yeah. So enjoy the ride, and there will be more coming, and we will be discussing it all right here. So it is getting late. So, gentlemen, thank you guys. Well, it's not late for Brendan, but... Anyway, guys, thanks for jumping on and talking about this news about Batman. It's coming and it's exciting. Brendan, thank you as always. Always nice to chat about this stuff. If the folks at home want to find you online, where can they do that?
You can find me on Twitter at Lowy007.
Sweet. And Sean, always good to have you back as well. Get you talking some Batman again. And if the folks at home want to keep up with you, where can they do that?
You can find me on Twitter personally at Mr. Sean Gerber, Sean spelled S-E-A-N. If you like Marvel, you can listen to my Marvel show on Twitter. It's at Marvel Newscast or Marvel Studios News. And if you like Star Wars, I've got a Star Wars show that I host with my buddy John Beerley. It's called Fandalorians, at Fandalorians on Twitter.
Sweet. But yeah, thank you guys both so much. It was really fun, really exciting, good stuff. And everybody out there listening, thank you most of all. Thank you for downloading the show. Thanks for joining us and allowing us to be excited about what is coming with the Batman. Please do subscribe to the show wherever you get your podcast so you never miss an episode. Please rate and review us on iTunes if you've got a minute. But most importantly, as Michael Keaton's Batman says, I want you to tell all your friends about me. Visit HolyBatCast.com. Find Holy BatCast on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Normally, we've got the Wayne Manor mailbox. We will cover that in the next episode when it's not the middle of the night. So if you've got an email for the Wayne Manor mailbox, you can send that to HolyBatCast@RF4RM.com. You can also leave us a voicemail at 323-366-9246. But that'll do it for this episode. On behalf of Brendan and Sean, I've been Andy. This has been Holy BatCast. We'll see you next time. Same bat time, same bat channel.
Holy BatCast is brought to you by Real Fans for Real Movies. Remember, the thoughts and opinions shared by the participants are theirs and theirs alone, and do not represent the companies or organizations they happen to work for.
And I said, okay, I want to do it. And the people from the studio were like, we're thrilled, we're so excited, and da-da-da-da, and we arranged it. And I said, listen, we want to talk to you because people go through this process and it's a little bit, you know, it can be trying. I said, what do you mean? So we want to show you some of the, like, reactions that past cast members, people who've been cast, have gotten, like, on the internet stuff. I was like, really? And so they send me, like, oh, when, you know, I won't even say who they were, people who were in these movies who did a great job.
Yeah.
And the people, you but know, these things were like, kill him!
No, you, this means amazing. A lot. It means, yeah, after the movie, you like it, you go, that was a great choice.
Yeah, it's like, before, who, like, you can't say, you know, before the movie comes out. I mean, how much, you know, it doesn't matter what people think then. It matters what you think when you see the movie, obviously. But I was like, I'm a big boy. You know what I mean? I don't need to.
I
could handle the Emmy snub.
Yeah.
I can handle anything.
So, I'll let you borrow it.
So I went on the. I said, just don't use the internet for a couple of days. And I said, I don't. This is not. I handle.
I'm tough. You know, there you go. Yeah. So, I'm tough.
Yeah, I'm very tough.
Boston,
so
yeah.
I saw the announcement. I look on this thing. I look down the first comment.
Yeah.
It's like, Ben Affleck's going to be Batman. The first one just goes, no! Like, maybe it's just...
Get off the internet, all right? Let's throw out the computers for a week. Yeah, I don't want to look at this
stuff. We're
going to
be Luddites for a while, kids.